This is a video about the bones of the lower leg, more specifically about the tibia and the fibula. The tibia is the main weight-bearing bone. It forms the shin and helps make up the joints at both the knee and the ankle. The fibula runs along the side of the leg, and while it doesn't bear much weight, it provides important muscle attachments and helps stabilize the ankle. So what we're going to do in this video is to go through the parts of each of these bones, look at their surface landmarks, and then talk a little bit about the joints that hold them together. What's up everyone, my name is Taim, I'm a medical doctor and I make animated medical lectures to make different topics in medicine visually easier to understand. If you would like a PDF version or a quiz of this presentation, you can find it on my website, along with organized video lectures to help with your studies. Alright, let's get started. So let's start with the tibia, and to keep things simple, let's isolate just this bone. Like any long bone, we divide it into three parts, the proximal end, the shaft, and the distal end. Let's look at all the landmarks related to the proximal part first. Now, right away, we can see two large expansions on either side. We've got the lateral condyle here and the medial condyle on this side. These are the two main load-bearing surfaces of the proximal tibia. If we just tilt it a little bit, we can see that both condyles carry superior articular surfaces, smooth regions where the femoral condyle sits. And right above these, we normally find the menisci, which help absorb shock, and together with all the ligaments and capsules form the knee joints, which we covered visually in the last video if you want to learn more about it in detail. Otherwise, on the lateral condyle, there's also an important site just off to the side, the fibular articular facet. This is where the fibula locks in and forms the superior tibiofibular joint. It's a small, plane-type synovial joint, doesn't move much, but is tightly bound and helps stabilize both bones together, especially during ankle movements. Between the condyles, we've got this raised ridge, the intercondylar eminence. Anterior to it is the anterior intercondylar area, and behind it is the posterior intercondylar area. Why are these important? Because this is where the cruciate ligaments of the knee attach. The anterior cruciate ligament, or ACL, anchors right into the anterior intercondylar area, along with parts of the medial and lateral menisci. And if we look at the back, the posterior intercondylar area gives attachment to the posterior cruciate ligament, or PCL, as well as the menisci. And as you see from this posterior view, the PCL sits deep into this area, anchoring the tibia to the femur and resisting posterior displacements. Lastly, just under the lateral condyle, there's a small bump called the tuberosity of the iliotibial tract, which provides attachment for the iliotibial tract, as you see here. So that was all the structures I wanted to highlight for the proximal part of the tibia. The view we are looking at right now is the anterior view of the tibia. If we flip it around, here is the posterior view of the lower leg. So let's go ahead and isolate the tibia from this view as well. Since we are done with the proximal end, let's now go through the landmarks associated with the shaft of the tibia. The first one to notice is this diagonal line running across the posterior surface, called the soleal line. This is where the soleus muscle originates, and it also serves as an attachment site for the transverse intermuscular septum, which separates the superficial and the deep muscle compartments in the posterior leg. Look at the front side of the leg now. We can find a really important bump here, called the tibial tuberosity. This is the insertion point for the quadriceps femoris. The quadriceps tendon runs over the patella and then continues as the patellar ligament, which inserts directly onto this tuberosity. So when your quads contract, they pull on this point, which extends the knee. In adolescence, overuse of this region can actually cause a condition called Osgood-Schlatter disease, where the tuberosity becomes painful and swollen. Now, let's look at the borders of the shaft. We've got three: the anterior border, which is this sharp ridge you can feel right down the front of your shin, the interosseous border, which is lateral and faces the fibula, and we can see the medial border, which runs along the inside. These borders divide the shaft into three surfaces. We've got the posterior surface facing backwards. This one gives origin to several deep flexor muscles like the tibialis posterior. Then we have the lateral surface, which lies between the anterior and the interosseous borders. This is where muscles like the tibialis anterior originates. And we got the medial surface, which faces inwards and is very subcutaneous, lying just under the skin. So you can easily palpate it on yourself along the shin. Alright, now let's move down to the distal end of the tibia. So let's zoom in. The first thing we see here is the medial malleolus, this prominent bony projection on the inside of the ankle. It forms the medial side of the ankle joint and provides attachment for the deltoid ligament, also known as the medial collateral ligament. It's a strong fan-shaped ligament that stabilizes the ankle and resists eversion. If we look at it from below, we can see the articular facet of the medial malleolus, which articulates with the talus. And next to it is the inferior articular surface of the tibia. This flat surface bears weight and articulates directly with the trochlea of the talus, forming part of the ankle joints. Looking at the posterior side, we can see the malleolar groove. This shallow depression guides the tendons of the tibialis posterior and the flexor digitorum longus muscles as they pass behind the medial malleolus. And finally, on the lateral side of the distal tibia, we've got the fibular notch. This is the groove where the distal end of the fibula fits in and gets held tightly by the tibiofibular syndesmosis, which help lock the tibia and the fibula together at the ankle. So that's all the structures I wanted to mention on the tibia. Let's now go ahead and focus on the fibula. So let's isolate the fibula now. Just like the tibia, the fibula also consists of three parts: the proximal end, the shaft, and the distal end. Let's begin with the proximal end. So, looking at the top of the fibula, we can see a small bony projection called the apex of the head of the fibula. And if we rotate the fibula just a little medially, you will notice this articular facet right here. This is where the fibula articulates with the lateral condyle of the tibia, forming the proximal tibiofibular joint. Now, these structures, the apex and the articular facet, are both part of the head of the fibula, which is this expanded upper portion. The head of the fibula serves several important roles. It provides insertion for the biceps femoris, origin for the soleus and the fibularis longus muscles, and acts as an attachment site for a bunch of ligaments, the fibular collateral ligament, arcuate popliteal ligament, and both the anterior and posterior ligaments of the fibular head. Just below the head, we have this narrow region called the neck of the fibula, which is clinically important because the common fibular nerve wraps around it. That means trauma or fracture here can easily injure the nerve, leading to foot drop. Alright, so that wraps up the structures of the proximal fibula. If we now look at the posterior view of the leg and isolate the fibula again, we can take a closer look at the shaft. Running along the shaft, we can see several borders and surfaces. Starting here, we've got the anterior border of the fibula, which runs vertically along the front. Just beside it is the interosseous crest. This is where the interosseous membrane attaches, linking the fibula to the tibia and helping maintain their alignment. On the backside, we've got the posterior border of the fibula. And then surrounding these borders are surfaces on the shaft. We've got the lateral surface, which lies between the anterior and the posterior borders. It gives origin to the fibularis muscles, like the fibularis brevis and longus. Then we have the posterior surface, where deep muscles like the tibialis posterior and flexor hallucis longus arise. And finally, the medial surface. This one faces the tibia and also provides origin for part of the extensor digitorum longus. So that was a quick overview of the shaft of the fibula. Let's now cover the structures associated with the distal end. So let's zoom in. The first thing we can see here is the articular facet of the lateral malleolus. As you see here, it sits tightly against the lateral side of the talus, forming the lateral part of the ankle joint. If we flip it around to the posterior view, we can see this depression called the malleolar fossae. It gives attachment to ligaments that stabilize the ankle joint. And running alongside it is the malleolar groove. This is where tendons of the fibularis brevis and the fibularis longus pass through. These tendons share a common tendon sheath, and they are held firmly in place by the superior fibular retinaculum as they curve around the ankle. So that was all the structures I wanted to highlight on the fibula. And with that, we have covered the tibia and the fibula of the lower leg. Now, how are the tibia and fibula actually held together? They're connected at three levels: along the shaft, up here at the proximal end, and down here at the distal end. Let's start with the proximal tibiofibular articulation. This is a plane type synovial joint between the lateral condyle of the tibia and the head of the fibula. It is supported by two ligaments, the anterior ligament of the fibular head and the posterior ligament of the fibular head. Then, along the shaft, we've got the interosseous membrane. This fibrous sheath spans between the interosseous borders of the tibia and the fibula. It stabilizes the bones, allows for muscle attachments, and helps transmit forces between the fibula to the tibia during movements. And lastly, at the distal end, we've got the distal tibiofibular joint, which is a syndesmosis, a fibrous joint that doesn't move much, but provides strong stability. This joint is reinforced by the anterior and the posterior tibiofibular ligaments. So that was everything I wanted to talk about for the tibia and the fibula. I really hope it was helpful. The next topic in our lower limb skeletal series is the bones of the foot. So if you're curious about how the tarsals, metatarsals, and the phalanges come together to form the arches and the structures of the foot, click the next video to continue learning, and I'll see you there. If you want a handmade PDF version of this lecture, take a quiz to test your knowledge, or access an organized list of all my videos, you can find everything on my website. Thanks for watching, see you in the next one.